are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. And I sing because you are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. You are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. And I sing because you are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. And I sing because you are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me.
Come on,
you
everybody,
are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me.
And I sing because
you are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me. You are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me.
Tell him this morning.
I sing because you are good and I dance because you are good and I shout because you are good. You are good to me.
All right. Turn to your neighbor and say, I love you.
I love you.
But I love Jesus more.
But I love Jesus.
You may be seated real quick. Ushers, if you guys would come on down. Quickly on announcements. Today at 6 o'clock, we are supposed to have a systems teaching. So that's at the 5th Street building. And then at 6:30, we'll start back up with Destiny Discovery. If you're not in Destiny Discovery, you need to learn about the Lord. Amen? Turn to your neighbor and say, you don't know as much as you think. All right. Personality class will start tonight. Turn to your neighbor and say, I think you need to go. All right. All right. The next thing, real quick. Who knows what year it is? Oh God, Robbie. What year is it? The year of the Lord. Okay, Let's quit. All you Jesus' second cousins, we're just speaking natural right now. What year is it? Okay. If it's 2016, we are no longer using a pencil and a pen to do the things that we do. Amen? Can I get an amen? We use electronics. Amen? We are on a computer. If you do not have a computer, raise your hand. Oh, you, some of you are telling stories. Okay. Good, bad, or indifferent. You know, technology can be evil. There's a lot of evil that comes through it, but it also can be good. You know, back in the Bible times, they were in a community that they could walk to everybody's house and they could break bread, and they were close to each other. Today, we are not that close, but electronics can bring us together. Amen? We can stay connected. Some of us too connected. Some of us too much, but that's a whole other message. The point that I'm trying to get across here is that the tech, we do not sign in up for a class. We do not check into church. We do not fill out forms on a paper anymore. We use electronics. One, it's a lot quicker. Two, we don't kill so many trees. And three, it is easily organized. So I'm asking you, no, I'm begging you. I'm begging you with all that I have in me. Please use your phone app to check in. Use your phone app to register. When we do a class, we need to know how many's coming. When we're having an event, we need to know how many's coming. Sometimes we have food for that. Sometimes we need to know how many chairs to set up. So please help us out with that. If you would, please turn to your neighbor and say that he's talking to you.
He's talking to you.
And see, and just ask Janie if you'll come to me. If your husband or wife will not get you a good phone, you just come to me. I help you get a good phone. Ask Janie. It worked. We got her a better phone. Amen? All right. But please help us out. Please check in. Use the app. If you do not have the app, see Pastor Wren, Pastor James, Pastor Annette, or Clayton, or Sherry, or Junior. Where's Junior? Hey, buddy. What's up? Especially Junior. Junior is probably the quickest. Him and Sherry will knock it out real quick. One of the two, and get you set up, all right? But with that app, you can go in and check into the classes and help us out so much. Say, let's help Pastor out. Come on. Thank you. Y'all are not in a good mood today, are you? Okay, what else we got? Oh, I need the other electronics. All right, so join. So register for the class. What else do we have? Negrons, we're glad you're back. They went up to Pennsylvania, right, to see his family. Bill swore he was going to drop her off on the way up there, but he brought her back. Okay, Mills of Grace, March 2nd. Janie, how many you need? You got everybody? Where you at? Four. We need four people for Meals of Grace. Meals of Grace, we go out to the neighborhood and bring food once a month. The food is mainly just a bridge to get in and minister to people and love on them. So if you would, we need four people. But if you've never been, I suggest that you get with Janie and go. It's awesome stuff. Amen? Okay. Small groups, connection points, go online after you get your app set up. And you can see how we connect within this facility outside of church. We have a bunch of small groups that meet once a month to the fellowship and talk about the pastor. So you'll enjoy that. Marriage conference, the 26th and the 27th. If you are having issues with your marriage, come. You will be blessed. If you want to better your marriage, come. You'll be blessed. If you want to get married, come. We'll pray over you and we'll find you a mate. Amen? All right. All right. What else we got? Y'all be in June, we're going to Peru. Please begin to pray about that and help as we do fundraisers to raise money for the kids to go. All right. And then on the 25th of March, Pastor Annette's going to do a Good Friday service. Y'all register for that and come and go. What else do I got, honey? Do what? No, I'll do that next week. All right, what else we got? Let's get our tithes and offerings ready, if you would, please. Let's bow first real quick. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning. We just ask that you would bless this offering. Bless those that give. Father, those that are unable to give. You said you give seed to the sower. So, Father, we just ask that that come forth. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, if you'd wait till he gets started on the nugget, and then you can start going, okay? If you would, make your checks out to the Point Christian Fellowship. If you want to go online and give, you can go online and give. And anything else? All right. Y'all give Bill a hand as he comes forward. Don't have it? Never mind. Never mind. All right. Miss, y'all give Pastor Hand, Annette a hand. Pastor Hand and Annette.
Good morning. Okay, Bill, morning. I'm covering for you, so. No, you're good. You're good. It's okay, baby.
This morning, prayer. Okay, make sure not everything falls out of my Bible, including my Bible. I was reading this morning, and the Lord kind of dropped this in my spirit, and I just wanted to share it with you to kind of give you a point of faith before you enter in this morning into worship. Amen? Y'all all right? In Joshua chapter 3, we have the account of when they're about to cross over the Jordan. Moses is now dead, and Joshua is about to take over the reins and lead them into the promised land. It's an exciting time for the children of Israel. And he says in verse 13, verse 11. He says, behold, the ark of the covenant of the Lord of all the earth is passing over before you into the Jordan. So now take 12 men from the tribes of Israel, one from each tribe. And the soles of the feet of the priests who bear the ark of the Lord of all the earth shall rest in the Jordan. The waters of the Jordan coming down from above shall be cut off, and they shall stand in one heap. So when the people set out from their tents to pass over the Jordan with the priests bearing the ark of the covenant before the Lord, before the people. And when those who bore the ark came to the Jordan, and the feet of the priests bearing the ark were in the brink of the water, so as soon as they got to the very edge of the water, it says that because the Jordan overflows its banks all the time of the year, the waters which were coming down from above stood and rose up in a heap far off at Adam and the city that is beside Zarethan. And those flowing down toward the Sea of the Arabah and the Dead Sea were wholly cut off, and the people passed over opposite of Jordan. As I read that this morning, I thought, you know, the priests, they stepped into the water, and it says that the waters that were coming from above stopped. And, I mean, can you even imagine what that would have looked like? Just like if water's flowing fast, and the Jordan, when it was in that season, the rainy season, it would like three times over its bank, it would get so large, and it would be rushing water. So the water stops, and it stands up in a big heap. Now, can you even imagine, first of all, what that would look like? I mean, if you were, like, standing there and looking and trying to cross over as this water is just literally standing before you stopped. And it would take faith to step into that riverbed, you know what I mean, on the dry ground, and not think that once you got into it, that water was not going to be, like, just overcoming you. You know what I mean? Well, I looked it up, and that when it said as far as Adam and to Zarethan, that word means man's distress. And the Lord has dropped in my heart that today there's a lot of us that we have man-made distress that looks like it is going to overpower us. But that there's a presence here today, that there are those who have already walked in before you. The water is standing up, and the Lord is asking you, would you cross over? Would you have the faith to step into the dry ground this morning? Do something you've not yet done before, and trust God that the thing that wants to overcome you will not overcome you. But you will really come on the other side of that thing. And you know what's really crazy is, just so you know, that because I know you're fighting a real war. We all have real things going on. We got real bills we can't pay. You got real sickness. You got real rejection, all these things. But do you know that when the priest stepped into the Jordan and the water stopped, at that moment, a report went to the enemy that the God that was with Moses is now with Joshua. And it says the enemy began to tremble and was afraid and already began to cower back. Do you know that whatever's trying to come against you, as soon as you say, Lord, I'm stepping in, that that is all that matters? The Lord's already taken care of that thing that's causing you distress. He's great. He's able to do all things abundantly above what we could ever ask, imagine, or think. And I believe that there's breakthrough in here for you today. I'm telling you. I feel faith level about right here, and that's really pathetic. I'm sorry. If you have something distressing in your life, do you want to keep it? Somebody put a quote that I put out there in 2008, said, you can't wring your hand. What did it say? You can't wring your hands and roll up your sleeves at the same time. You can't worry and have victory at the same time. You just got to say, you know what, Lord? In this moment, I'm going to abandon whatever thoughts I have right now that are causing me to be distressed, whatever worries, whatever thing is plaguing my soul, I give them over to you. And I thank you that they will not overcome me today. Amen? Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. All right. She did good. Amen. All you guests, thank you for coming today. We have in her description of the things coming against, we have a lot of sickness going on. We got a lot of battles, people in trouble, people having attacks on them and have got them out. It's been one person after another getting the flu. Me and the flu are fighting right now, and I'm putting them under my feet, but every once in a while a wave comes and I feel like I get knocked on my butt, but I'm going to press in and press through. So with that said, let's all bow our heads. Let's stand. We're fixing to come up here to worship, but let's pray again, because the spirit of infirmity keeps coming at this place. So let's rebuke it one more time, and then let's lift up a standard of faith, all right? Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today. Father, as we are moving forward, as we're stepping forward, as we're stepping into onto that dry ground, Father God, as the sea is pulled back and drawn up, Father God, and we just ask, Father God, that you would stir in us, that you're the Spirit of the Lord. One of the gifts is faith, Father God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of the Lord. Faith comes by extending obedience, which operates love or shows love, and faith then operates by that love. So, Father, we come in obedience, and whatever you speak to our heart, we will do, that, Father, we may operate in that love, and then we may hear your words, and we may hear your direction and your commands. And Father, stir up in us the gift. Let us rise up. Let us raise up a standard, Father God, and come against the enemy that's coming against us. No longer staying defensive. No longer staying back trying to hold ground or give up a little ground and not give up too much. But let's go on the offense, Father God, that we go across the sea, across the river, into the promised land, Father God, that we will rebuke what's on the right, what's on the left. We'll rebuke what's behind us, and we'll move forward into the kingdom of God, into the promises that he has for us. And all God's people said, amen and amen. If you missed the tithe bucket, bringing these buckets up here, let's come up here and let's worship the King. Come on, let's have a good time in the Lord. Come on, help us.
Your glory, we will
will dance. We will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord. For salvation's in this place, your name by which we're saved, Jesus, Jesus. Let your name be lifted high as our grateful hearts now cry, Jesus. Shout to shake the sky, lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord. We will dance for your glory. We will dance for your glory. Glory, Lord. We will lift up a shout to adore you. Every sound that we make, it is for you. We will dance for your glory, Lord. For salvation's in this place, your name by which we're saved, Jesus. Our grateful hearts now cry, Jesus, Jesus. Lift up your heads, you ancient gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. Lift up your head, your hands with ancient gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be glorified. Coming in. We're the people of God, we've a song to sing, and we're bringing our lives as an offering. We will dance for your glory, Lord. And your cross is the hope that we hold up high, as we tell the whole world of your love and light. We will dance for your glory, Lord. People of God, we've a song to sing, and we're bringing our lives as an offering. We will dance for your glory, Lord. And your cross is the hope that we hold up high, as we tell the whole world of your loving light. We will dance for your glory, Lord. Offering, we will dance for your glory, Lord. And your cross is the hope that we hold up high, grateful hearts now cry, Jesus, Jesus. Lift up your head, you ancient gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up your heads, you ancient gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. We lift up a shout to shake the sky. Lift up a cry, be glorified. The King is coming in. The King is coming in. Thank you.
just a moment there, you set me free. Oh, that saved me, that rescued me. Just a moment there, you set me free. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory. I give you glory, glory, Jesus. I give you glory, glory.
Overwhelmed.
I ask for the nation.
Dear Heavenly Father, we love you. We praise you with all our heart. Father, there's marriages that need to be restored. There's children that are wayward. There's finances that need touching. There's jobs that need to be obtained. We come to you today and we ask in Jesus' name. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Now, whether it's you or whether it's your friend or a family member, what is that nation? What is that thing that is needed? He said, ask. Father, in Jesus' name, yes and amen. Yes and amen. Yes and amen. Yes and amen. Father, let signs and wonders begin to follow that word. Yes and amen. Let as they walk out today, let them get texts right now. As they walk out, as they go tomorrow morning, as they walk into the office, as they go to the person that is sick, as they go to the person that they're in conflict with. Yes and amen. Yes and amen, Father. And all God's people said, amen. Turn to your neighbor, tell them you love them, tell them you're glad they're here this morning. If you could, please, those, if you guys could squeeze to move towards the inside of the row so people are coming in that we can get some people seated. Thank you. We are used to a family church, and we're growing past that. That doesn't mean we're not still family, but we get bigger than just family, so we got to let guests come and sit beside us. Amen. And then make them family. Amen? All right, turn to your neighbor and say, you're family. And I'm the black sheep in your family. All right. All right, if you would, hang on. I lost my mic, so I'm having to use this handheld. I say lost. Right now it's misplaced. My wife said I probably left it at home. That's where I left most of my stuff. My brain. My nice comfy bed. I don't usually use this, but I didn't write any notes today. Yeah. The Lord dropped something in my heart, and it's just been hard getting it out. So we're going to wing it. Is that all right? All right, good. like you got a choice or anything. I don't need that one. I want to talk to you this morning about leaven. I want to talk to you about making some bread or making some alcohol. What? I really don't. This is kind of strange. I really didn't get to do what all I wanted to do. I seriously, Annette was sick and finished preaching Wednesday night. Came home and we went to run some stuff. And by the end of the day, Thursday, she was whooped. Friday, she was terrible. Yesterday, she started feeling better. Well, it started hitting me Friday night kind of the same way. So yesterday was a long day. Last couple of nights have been long, and I didn't get to study it out and do what I wanted to do with it, normally do with it. But God dropped this in my heart, and we're just going to, hopefully it'll bless you. But what started it was, as it's like, seriously, around here, if you go to this church, there's a lot of guests here. I just want to thank you so much. We got some ugly people in our church, and you have made it so much more beautiful by being here this morning. Amen. Especially in the front row. You know, I've begged them to sit on the back row, but they keep coming up. But anyway, we just want to thank you for being here. But if you know anything about this church, we have an awesome presence of God here, and we have God just blesses us so. But there seems to be this attack of sickness that comes. Sickness, offense, and a couple others just kind of waves and waves, and sickness keeps coming back. And flu is on the rampage. We got rid of viral and throwing up and all that, and now flu's here. And Nona's usually the first one get it. She's one of our elders, and I think probably we got a sin problem over there in that house. So y'all help me pray, get that cleaned up. If y'all that are guests, that's one of our elders, and she's a precious woman of God, but she's got a real awesome husband that carries the weight. But anyway. But anyway, flu's been coming at us, and we're fighting it, and I'm winning. I'm gonna kick its butt. Amen. But it started. God started talking to me about it just a little bit. You know, Pastor Annette made mention of how she thought she got it, and it just takes a drop. It just takes just a little bit to infiltrate, and then it just kind of ravishes your body, right? It's not like it's this deluge of flu stuff. It just comes in as a little bacterial, viral, whatever it is, small microscopic thing. And the Lord touched on me about leaven, and he talks about leaven. And a lot of times when we talk about leaven, we only look at sin. And today when I'm talking about, it's so good to see you. I'm glad you're here today. Not you. I know you. It's good to see you. Speaking of these two other wedding invitations, you're all invited. On the info booth, right as you go out, grab. It's March what? 5th. And speaking of March 5th, Meals of Grace is not March 2nd, it is March 5th. So those that caught that, thank you for not correcting me. But those that didn't catch it, thank you for being just like me and slow. All right. So let's get back. I'm going to drag this out and make it an hour, and it's 10 minutes. Hush. Don't be shaking your head at me, woman. But anyway, it's just, we think of leaven and we think about the sin, but it's just a little bit, and it it leavens the whole loaf. So I begin to dig up a little bit about leaven, and let me just read a little bit to you, and then I want to talk to you, and then we'll go home. Actually, we're going to let some people join our church. We're going to bring them in, pray over them, and then we're going to baptize some people. Amen. And if you need to get baptized, you can join us, you can get baptized too. And if you've already been baptized, you can get baptized again. There's no rule against it. All right? So those that are legalistic, come see me afterwards, and we'll talk about it. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 5. And while y'all are going there, I'm going to tell you this. Leaven means that makes the bread rise. It also means to ferment carbohydrates, dough or a liquid. Ferment means to a chemical change with effervescence. Yeast causes either ethanol and alcohol or carbon dioxide in bread. Both of those cause those to ferment. So the yeast and alcohol will cause the ethanol to be produced, and the yeast in bread will cause carbon dioxide, which gives the bread air and causes it to rise. And the Lord speaks to us about the leaven in the bread, and we associate it with sin. And we're going to go, are you there? 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 6. We'll start at 1. That's good. Let's go back to 1. Let's just start there. We hadn't read that much this week. It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and such sexual immorality as is not even named among the Gentiles, that a man has his father's wife. And you are puffed up and have not rather mourned that he has done this deed might be taken away from you, from among you. For I indeed, as an absent in body, but present in spirit, have already judged, as though I were present, him who has so done this deed. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, when you are gathered together along with my spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, deliver such one to Satan for the destruction of flesh, that his spirit might be saved in the day of the Lord Jesus. Your glorifying is not good. Do you not know that a little leaven leavens the whole lump? Therefore, purge out the old leaven, that you may be a new lump, since you truly are unleavened. For indeed, Christ, our Passover, was sanctified for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast not with old leaven, nor with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. And we'll stop right there. There's a lot right there, and just God just exploded a bunch into me, and I'm gonna just throw some highlights out there, and then we're gonna talk about what I want to talk about, and then we'll get out of here. Do we know any church that does what I just read? I mean, if you go into a church today, let's go into Joe Olstein's church. Let's go into any big mega church that you want to. Could you imagine them addressing someone that had that and getting them out of the church? Ooh, you ought to see y'all's faces looking at me. Y'all like, what? You better back up. Better back up. See, church is going to get to where it's supposed to pretty quick when Jesus comes back. He has to. He has to make it without spot and without blemish. He has to get it ready. And a lot of us think, oh, that's you. I don't know about that. Because man is man, and man gets all kinds of trouble, and you can get into all kinds of different doctrine. You can get all kinds of no grace, and you can get all and pointing the finger and tearing people down. And yes, you're right. But if we really read those scriptures, you'll see, if you really let God show you, that it's out of a purity of heart. And it's really, he says, without the leaven of malice and wickedness. And see, we think that that's applied to the sin that we're getting rid of, but what that is the person that is removing the sin or getting addressing the sin. That's the malice and the wickedness that needs to go away. With the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth, when you come sincerely and truthful to someone to address someone's issue and to deal with something in their life, you're bringing something. You're loving them more than if you just come behind them and hug them and say, it's going to be okay and it's all right. You can continue to do that until God gets it out of you. It's going to be okay, or not even address it at all. See, it's my favorite thing is if the baby's coming up to the stove and there's hot grease, if you're from the South and you like some fried chicken like I do and some French fries and you like that just boiling all over the stove, all four or five greasy pans just going to town with some butter dips in the oven and some baked beans in the oven and the baby comes up and he's trying to get a hold of that pan. Now, every one of us would say no and get him away because we know what would happen. But if that baby kept on, you would get more and more stern, not because you're condemning, not because you're trying to convict or judge him, because you don't want that baby burnt, right? Okay. See, the thing is that the little bitty thing that comes into us does have an effect. It does. It affects us. See, me and one of my sons were having a discussion yesterday, and I balanced through this of what I can watch and what I can't watch, what I can do and what I can't do. And I really didn't know that conversation was going to be in with what I'm doing today, but and I'm getting to the other part, but I want to deal with this part first. Let's give a couple of examples. You go to church every day. Something happened in your life, and you're going every Sunday, and you're going every Wednesday. You're coming faithful. Something, for me, let's just use me. For me, I was going through a divorce, and my life was falling apart, and I had been in the church when I was younger, and I'd gotten away. I'd partied. I'd partied hard. I was the best. I was the best at it. Whenever I do something, I do it well. Amen? And I did that well. Well, I was coming back into the church, and I was, every time the doors were open, I was there. Every morning I was reading the Bible because I was trying to get God to help me. I needed help. I knew nobody could help me but God. And at some point you come to that realization. Some of us come to the realization, well, we'll give him a try. No, and that's okay. At least you're making some attempts. Sometimes you get to the point where there's nothing else is going to work. And you know that even if there's not a God, or even if there is a God, or I don't know, I hope there's a God, and I need something to move in my life. Amen? And when you're at that point, you're going to go to church. You're going to go do whatever you can do. And other people do other different types of things, and they do it. But really, they're looking for a God, right? They're looking for a creator, a father, a being that is more powerful than them to change their circumstances, right? And we who know Jesus Christ and who know the Father of heaven, who know God, who is God, the Jehovah, the self-existent one, who knows the God, the only God, when we know that that's the way, that's the only way. Now, they are looking for the same answer. They're just looking at it in a different place, right? And we want to get all critical, but really they're searching for the same thing, right? They're just not warm yet. But we get to that point, and we're fervently going, and we're going 90 to nothing, and we're searching, and we get through that. In my case, the marriage didn't get fixed. But I got through that, and I began to see where God was taking me. And then he had to convince me that's the way I needed to go. Because it was with her, and she was mean. But there was a period of time when there was no, the fervency to do all that had an opportunity to wane. But the thing was, is my relationship with a woman was not the only thing that was wrong with my life. It was just the one that was sore. It was the one that was messed up. And so the squeaky wheel gets the oil. The screaming kid gets the candy. Right? Or the belt, whichever one. Whichever one. Right? And I'll tell you, the ones that get the belt, you're loving them more than the ones that give them the candy, but that's a whole different message. But that wanes, and it had an opportunity to wane, but with me, I was not going to let it, because I knew, at that point, I came to the realization that I had been called since I was 5 years old. I knew I had something to do, and God was pressing on me, and I didn't stop. And through the years, there's been times that I have waned a little bit, but I have never stopped. I've wanted to quit many times. I've stayed at home and sucked my thumb and pouted and wet my pants and all of that whole thing. But I got up on Wednesday night, and I got up on Sunday. And there was times that I didn't read the Bible, but there was times that I didn't pray, but I always came back to it. But my point to that is when those times of waning, those times of pulling away, those times of not doing, what had happened was this little thing had come into my life. Now, for me, it was something I didn't get. And it came in, and I began to think over and 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 over from the time I got up to the time I went to bed. It just first started as just a fleeting thought. It just came as just a little thing, but then all of a sudden it consumed me, and it was, I'm not getting what I want. And what came as just one passing thought became all consuming. Now, I'm going to use me as an example so I don't point anybody out, but I'll just give you an example, and I won't tell you when it was. I'll just tell you what happened. See, I was looking at this woman on a website that was in a bikini. Actually, it was a magazine. Just the cover. At the store. I just looked. Then I was out at the lake, and there was women that kind of looked like that woman that caught my eye in the magazine store. It was just one look. But it wasn't just one look. It was a look and a thought. And then it grew and it grew and it grew, and before you know it, I'm looking at porno. It was just one line, because I had to go to work the next day, and I was out with my friends, and we were having a good time. I was celebrating life real well. It was just one line, but that one line turned into shooting an 8-ball a day. Just a little bit. It's just one little bitty offense. And coming to church every time the doors open, reading and praying, it's one little pastor didn't do whatever pastor didn't do, or Sister Susie sat in my seat, or whatever. It's just one little thought of, I'm going to slap her. And the thing is, most of the time, what is so awesome, the delivery system of that offense, is that you're right. And before you know it, you're murdering them in your mind. Oh, man, if Sister Susie just walks out and just kind of steps out off the curb. There's coming fast. She'll be out long enough that she won't remember where she sits, and she won't sit in my seat anymore. It's just, see, what I'm trying to get across is it's just a little bit of yeast leavens the whole lump, and it makes it rise up, and it makes it, it affects everything, and we identify with sin, what is sin, and we identify leaven with sin, and that's the easy part. But the thing is we don't recognize it. And part of the conversation was what was right and what's wrong. You know, is having a drink wrong? You can show me where not to drink in the Bible, and I can show you where you can. And you can tell me that it wasn't fermented, and I can tell you you need to dig a little deeper. We want to argue about that. I don't want to argue about it. You say don't do it, we don't do it. When I'm around you, I don't do it. Because I know another scripture that says, if what you see me do causes you to stumble, then I don't need to do it because I have an obligation. I said that to my son, and he said, where's the freedom? I said, we don't have freedom. We're in bondage to Christ. And as a leader, you have to take that course. You have to take that step. You have to take that lead because you're leading people out. And what you don't understand is you guys are all pointing at me, but you're leaders at home. You're leaders in your office. You're leaders at school. You are the Christ sent to whoever, wherever. Once you accept him, you are anointed, appointed, and you are engaged and prepared for battle. And you're sent out to the front lines right from the get-go, from right here, you're birthed and you're put a sword in your hand and you're sent right out. See, if we dig this scripture down, we would see that, bottom line, it's out of spirit and truth, and what God lays on your heart, he'll show you and he'll take you through that. But what I want to show you guys is it's just a little bit. It only takes a little bit. This is the good news. Go with me to Matthew 13:33. Let's go up a little bit from that. Where's the talk about the kingdom? I mean the seed. There we go. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all the seeds. But when it is grown, it is greater than the herbs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and nest in its branches. Another parable he spoke to them, the kingdom of heaven is like leaven. Whoa, 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 whoa. Back up. Back up. Do we pay attention to what we read? Do we pay attention to what the preacher preaches? Because he just said the kingdom of heaven is like leaven, and we all get associated with leaven as sin. Which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal till it was all leavened. And all these things Jesus spoke in the parables, and we don't need that part. Three measures of meal and three areas of food, three times complete, divine completeness. A little leaven was put in, and it was all leavened. See, we look at the power of sin and what it can do. And we can come in and we see it, and everybody's I would be a rich man if I bet on this. A person coming in with a broken relationship, I can put $1,000 and win 90% of the time. Person comes in with a broken relationship. God heals them. The person leaves. They're just loving God, and they're all right. As soon as they start stepping forward with God, there is going to be a partner. Some kind of relationship is going to come and produce itself or present itself to that person. Every time. Every time. Why? To get them out. To get them out. We're moving along and we're worshiping. We're doing one little offense will get people to be irritated with the very person they thought walked on water. This gets said to me all the time. Man, Pastor, this thing is going to explode. They've been here two services, one service. Pastor, I see this exploding. You're going to have multiple services. You're going to have to build another building. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be just. Phew. You are so real. You're real. You are so just too real. You talk down to earth. You're right with us. You are. It's just this place. I can feel the presence of God. It's just awesome. And as soon as me or anybody else in this church brushes up a little crossways with them, choom, and I could be wrong, fairly unlikely, you know, but in the cases that it did happen. Just boom. If this is going to be the thing happening, if this is going to play, so why aren't you staying? I'm inevitably going to say something from this pulpit that's going to rub you wrong. Sometimes I try. Sometimes it just comes easy. Right? But inevitably it's going to happen. It's going to rub you wrong. It's just one little thing. I could have gave you a word that read your book, and you knew there was no way. You could have swore I was in your closet. I have told people things that just, it scared me. And I believe in him, and I believe in the prophetic. I've said stuff to people, and I found out other stuff afterwards, and it was kind of freaky. Just being honest. Just being real, down to earth, real. Because I know how messed up I am. And for God to use me that way. They can come in, get the relationship restored, job fixed, just God blessing. And one little thing sends them off the way. And what I'm trying to point out is that one little leaven leavens the whole lump, and it messes up the whole lump. But we concentrate on that. That was one of the things that we were talking about yesterday, and I guess maybe that's why that we had that conversation, or maybe that's why we're coming this way with this message, because I was delusional most of the day yesterday. Now you know who I was talking to. But we concentrate on the bad. We concentrate on the sin. We've had many anointed people come in here, and we've had many of them fall, and every one of them we have tried to restore. But most places, you mess up, you're done, you're out, you're gone. How does one thing negate you? David, he committed adultery, he lied, he committed murder, and covered all of it up. Now, I'm not condoning any of those things, and if you did any of those things, you need to repent. It's not a pass. That's not my point. But the thing doesn't negate what God has done and what he's done for you and what he will do for you. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman, the church, took and hid in 3 measures of meal. Apostolic, prophetic, and the 3 pastor evangelist teachers, all put in 3. If you look in Corinthians, Romans, it shows you apostle, prophet, and then teachers, which is inclusive of the teacher, the pastor, and the evangelist. Put it into those and leaven the whole lump. Because what does the fivefold ministry do? They equip the body to do the work of the ministry. And so in that, the Spirit of the Lord is placed in those 3, that little bit of leaven, and it goes in and the whole body is then affected. And we want to negate because someone comes in and they have this issue. But he says the kingdom of heaven is like leaven. And the kingdom of God, when it comes, not Jesus, not your interpretation of what church is about, but the kingdom of God. How many knows that God didn't come to establish heaven, establish for us to get to heaven? How many knows that he didn't establish for us to just accept Jesus as our Savior? How many knows that he didn't come just that you might have a relationship with Jesus? He came to establish the kingdom as on in heaven, on earth. He came to establish that kingdom. And that's why he said the kingdom of heaven is like leaven. It's coming and it's going to infiltrate and it's going to permeate all throughout your family. And we look at the sin and we look at the issues and we look at the little things and we let them explode in us. And we disqualify ourselves or other people because of the one little thing. And in that 1 Corinthians, when we were talking about it, he said, get malice and wickedness out of your heart and let the sincerity of the truth and the sincerity. Well, let's go back to 1 Corinthians 5:8, I think it is. We're almost finished. Quit yawning. Make me want to scream louder or get right by you. But the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth, the unleavened whole truth, the bread. You know why in the feast why it was 7 days of unleavened bread? Because it's all pure Jesus. And then he adds us with it and it rises up. Because we're not perfect. He is so good. He is so good. He's not going to leave you that way. The little thing you got to get rid of. See, the message is that little thing, it's going to affect you. It's going to change you. You allow that gossip to come in your ear, you're going to start gossiping. You let that show come in and you start watching it, you're going to start letting that be effective in your life. It's going to come in and it's going to change the way you believe and the way you think. If you don't put up a standard, it will infiltrate you and it will tear down a stronghold of the mighty one in your life and it will establish another stronghold of the evil one. Because he said faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. Well, fear or evilness comes by hearing and hearing of the word of Satan. You ever heard that law just opposite? Goes that way, you understand? I don't know how to explain that because it's way over my head. Rob may be able to, but say it.
The law of reciprocity, whatever works one way, works the other way also.
You open the door, it's coming in. It's coming in to take you out. You think it's innocent. You think that little touch of her butt is innocent. You think that little joke in the office as she's bent over picking up a box? You think that little glance is innocent? You think that little flirtation, that little conversation is innocent? You think that inappropriate communication, that dinner, that any one of it, you think that's innocent? That's just a little thing. No, it's one of the 3 enticements that came to Jesus. It's one of the 3 coming at you. But the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords said, the kingdom of heaven comes like a little leaven, and all you got to do is allow the anointed, sincere, truthful bread to come, and it'll change.
But see, it's the sincere and this truthful unleavened bread. It's the purity. See, the reason why that it's not effective, all right, let's say that all of you are sinners, bad, wicked, got all kinds of issues. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's talking about you. You got all kinds of issues. Okay, listen, and we're all going to this church, and you got all these kinds of issues going on. And me, my pureness comes in, all holy. And I'm just a little bit of the kingdom. Just a little bit of sincere, unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. All right, I'm that little bit, and I come in. I should affect and change all of you. Right? That's what should happen based on what I'm teaching you, what I'm telling you. Why doesn't it? Why doesn't it? Because me coming in will come in with an attitude, with an agenda, with an issue, or whatever. And so it's not pure coming in to make a change. Now, you're saying, well, then we're in trouble. Let's just put it that way. Then, Pastor, we might as well just give up. Well, the thing is that it comes that where there's no malice or wickedness, it's in the truth of the Holy Spirit. It's putting ourselves in righteousness. He said, if I will stay before the Lord and stay in righteousness, if I'll stay in right standing with him and don't let myself be moved. And you say, well, then, okay, I still can't mess up. No, that's not what he said. He said, if I am smart enough to say, I'm sorry, forgive me, it's my fault, pound my chest, I'm full of sin, I am less than I am, and I humble myself before him, he is faithful to forgive. And when he forgives, it puts me right back in right standing. That doesn't mean that I've stopped doing it. It means, okay, I need help, Lord. I need you to fix me. I need you to change me. And I'm going to resist everything, but I need your help. It puts me in right standing. And so when I come in, then I can be effective to all. The thing is that fight goes on day in and day out, day in and day out. Sometimes I'm in that right place, and we are kicking butt. And then Annette comes along, and then this other person comes along, and this other person comes along. And that pureness, that righteousness, that unleavened sincerity and truth comes into a church, comes into a place of occupation, comes into a school, comes into an organization, comes into whatever your life is, and then it joins up another, and 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 then what happens is it starts taking over. And it doesn't put it all on us. It puts it all on him. But the last thing I want to leave you with that doesn't work. That does not work as Lone Rangers. Ephesians, Galatians, one of them tells us that Jesus went to hell, grabbed the keys, he came back up. And he took the keys to death and loss. And he came back up. And when he came back up, he came to bring us life. But what did he do? He gave us gifts. Apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. To equip us to do the work of the ministry. If those came to equip us to do the work of the ministry, and the Holy Spirit was given to us to lead us into all truth, then those working together lead us into all truth, and the fivefold ministry corrects and fixes and adjusts us to do the work of the ministry. And what is the work of the ministry? Ministry is servanthood. What is serving? Serving God and serving man. So the fivefold ministry comes in and they start speaking and I start preaching and I preach something that rubs you wrong. It rubs you raw, ticks you off, wants to make you wants to punch me, and that God's dealing with you and I don't even know it and you get mad at me. You're having a conversation with your best friend, and they are moving in the pastoral ring right there because you're counseling, and they're talking. Actually, you're looking for someone to join up with you on your issue and agree with you. But they stand firm and they speak truth to you, and they say something to you that rubs you the wrong way. If you allow the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth to come in and change you, you will be effective. But we don't want to allow those to be effective. And so, therefore, we don't take over the workplace. We don't take over our families. We don't take care over our marriages. We don't take over the schools. We don't take over the hospitals. We don't take care over the city. We don't take care over the nations because we won't allow ourselves. Because I can get just as much God and word as you do, Pastor. Yeah, you can. And what you don't understand and what you don't realize is you being a part of the body, you will teach me just as much as I'll teach you. It's not me that you're submitting to. It's the fivefold ministry that you're submitting to. Because that's established. That's why church is so important. To keep you on track. Because when we're out here, we're selfish. We're going to do what we want to do the way we want to do it. I know. I'm that way. I know. I understand completely. I want what I want. When Annette's sick, it's like, hurry up and get unsick so you can take care of me. And I'm ticked off. I'm not lying one bit. I ain't joking nothing. Yeah, I know y'all know. Because I am spoiled rotten. And I deserve it. She's God's favorite. And I deserve to be spoiled. You better hush, woman. Allow that to come into our lives, and we'll get more and more pure. We may not even change what we do, but we'll get more and more pure. And in that, then we'll have more and more power. And then when we come up to lay hands on people, they'll truly be made whole. When we go speak to someone, we'll know exactly what to speak. Sometimes some of y'all need to just shut up and stop talking about Jesus and be Jesus. Some of you need to quit being Jesus and you need to say something. Because your version of Jesus is not working. And you need to declare to them. They need to hear you. You need to confront them. But you don't know that unless the Holy Spirit's there to lead you into all truth. What needs to be said? For this one, this needs to be said. For this one, that needs. For this one, nothing. We don't know. But if we'll get alone with God, if we'll get alone, just one little piece leavens the whole lump. Just imagine if you increased your alone time with God by 10 minutes. Not saying where you're at, what you're doing. Just increase it by 10 minutes. You're in the presence of Almighty God. You're going to change. And in that, then you're going to change things around you. And you're going to be that one little leaven. Because, see, when you start talking to God, he's going to tell you what you need to fix. And when that happens, then if you allow that, if you'll let that start fixing, then what? If you'll listen, then you're going to hear about it in church. Then it's going to be confirmed. So you heard it in your heart, and then when you come to church, you're going to hear it, and you're going, I got to give that money. I got to call Sister Susie. I got to go see Duma Falachi. I got to do this. I got to do that, because it's going to get confirmed. And then when you're in obedience, and then more and more and more and more, and that one little leaven, it's going to leaven the whole lump. Amen.
Let's bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, if you are being baptized, go ahead and go get dressed. If you are joining the church today, I want you to come over here, right over here, and stand right here. But every head bowed, every eye closed. Dear Heavenly Father, my heart's cry is that we would recognize those little things that come into our life that are coming to destroy us. Come on, everybody heads bowed, every eye's closed, unless you're getting up for one of those two things. Okay? Father, let us recognize those little areas that weigh heavily in the balance of our lives, that is going to affect us. It's going to cause us loss. But Father, I would probably say most in here know those. I just ask that you let them know that you love them anyway and that you want to give them the power to overcome it. I just ask that they would repent and turn the other way. But Father, I want to declare and ask you this. Let them see their ability to make a difference. Let them see they are leaven wherever they're at, in their homes, in their schools, in their workplace, at the grocery store, at the ball game. And they were sent there to make a change. They are the agent that activates change. As one of the definitions said of yeast. Let them, Father God, be empowered with those words. Then, Holy Spirit, please fill them up to overflowing. Impart unto them faith. Give them courage and boldness. Open their ears and open their eyes. Open their heart and touch their will. And let them, Father God, be yielded completely unto you and go make a difference wherever they're called. Now, before we pray for these, if there's anybody in here that wants to accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, or wants to make a change, if you would come right over here to the left, to your right side over here, James and Wren and Darlene and Greg, would y'all go over there? If you want, every head bowed, every eye closed, if you want to make a prayer, just a declaration of change, if you want to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Okay, then I expect next week for you to bring somebody because you've heard the word and you're ready to go do it. Father, we just say yes and amen. We ask, Father God, that you activate them. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. If you guys would come stand right over here, elders and pastors and deacons, get around them, and then the rest of the church. These lovely folks want to join our church. It's the way we do it. We bring them up and we pray over them. So all members come up here and get around them. Love on them. We ready? Dear Heavenly Father, we stand on the word that says that you place members within the body. So we come to you today and we say thank you for the privilege of receiving these people into our community, into our body. We just ask that you bless them for their obedience. We're grateful for their gifts, and Father God, we just ask that you pour out on them a blessing that they cannot contain for stepping into obedience with you, lining up in the body that you've called them to do. Father, we just ask that every word, every bit of Bible they know get re-illuminated and expanded right now in Jesus' name. We ask, Father, for a hunger and a thirst for your righteousness and for the Word and for the Holy Spirit. We ask, Father God, that you bless them in the city and in the country. We ask them, bless them in the going and the coming. We ask them, Father, and whatever they do, whatever they put their hand to, that they would prosper. We ask for her natural resources to bless them with. We ask, Father God, for family members to get saved. We ask, Father God, for people to get healed in their lives. We ask, Father God, for miracles to happen. We just ask, Father God, that you pour out, as you did for Israel as they left Egypt, we just ask that as they're stepping into your promise for them, Father God, that you just pour out on them, Father, in Jesus' name. And Father, we ask that you open their hearts, that whatever they have to do, Father God, that you would show leadership, and that you would illuminate to them what they are to do. And then, Father, help us come together and equip and empower and encourage and establish, Father God, and come alongside to do whatever they're called to do. And then, Father God, we just ask that if they're coming in, that you seal this covenant with your blood, Father. That, Father, that as we're making this commitment today to stand by one another in spirit, in truth, in the emotional realm, in the physical realm, in the soulless realm, every need and everything that is attacked or blessed, we come together to fight or guard. We make that commitment to you today, Lord. Leadership in this church makes a commitment to listen to you, be guided by you, to impart, to equip, encourage, disciple. And Father God, they make a commitment to you to step into their place and anoint. And Father, as we make this commitment, we just ask for you to seal it by the Holy Spirit and help us live up to our covenant. And Father God, if by chance you have to send them somewhere else, Father, at some time, we ask, Father, that as they're coming in today with hands laid on, receiving into this fold, that they would be sent out the same way, Father, with hands laid on, praying over and blessing as they go to wherever you've called them to. Father, we thank you for this gift in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hug them and tell them you love them. Tell them you're glad they're here. If you would, those that are getting baptized, come on up. Okay, we got a few to baptize. So if you would, make it back to your seat. Give us just a second here. Okay, guys, can everybody get seated, please, real quick? Turn it down just a little bit. Okay. Come on, baby. Robbie, after you get them in, step aside so they can see. All right. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this gift that you've placed within this body. We thank you, Father God, for the blessing that this family is. I feel like the Lord is about to reveal to you where you question, what am I, who am I, what do I do? The Lord says that your family is a pillar within this community, and that you have been placed here to come alongside. You are a servant, but you are a compassionate, heartfelt, loving couple that will make people that come into this body welcomed. You are a pillar. But there's specific things that the Lord is going to be revealed to you this next year. But quickly and in an exponential fashion, the Lord is about to pour onto you a confidence in what you have already have in you, the giftings that are in you, and then they're going to start exploding. You're going to start seeing financial breakthroughs. You're going to start seeing prayers answered quickly. You're going to start seeing. You're going to say things you're not going to understand. What you say is going to come about quickly and in an instant fashion. Things are going to happen because faith is going to build up and rise up in you, and you're going to begin to speak. The Lord is bringing multiple couples and multiple relationships into your life over the next couple of years that will be long-lasting, and that you will help grow them up in the ways of the Lord. You have a heritage that your family has that you're passing down to your children. You will bring them in because they don't have that heritage. They don't have that legacy. And you will make them a part of your family, and you'll make them a part of your life. And they will be like brothers and sisters to you, and they will have what has been passed down to you, you will share. You will be like Jonathan, loving and anointing. And those that some will go into roles that you think will be bigger and better, but you are equipping and empowering people to move into roles that God has placed in, and your value is more than theirs because you are what sets them in place. You're the what speaks to them, what encourages them, and what breaks off of them. What's been placed on them by the enemy. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You ready?
Guys, as she was coming up, I heard the Lord say prophet, and then as she was stepping over, I heard evangelist. And the Lord said, they're a prophet declaring what the Lord says over a region, but evangelical because you're going to draw many to, because of what you declare is going to draw many to the kingdom. She's bold, and she has all this in her for a reason. There's a reason, because she's going to tear down some major strongholds in families, but also in communities. Thank you, Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this precious gift. We thank you, Father God, for the boldness that you've placed in her. And we thank you, Father God, for the radical things that you're doing in her life, in this family's life. In Jesus' name, amen.
We're all about to be baptized.
I hear many talk about angels and how they tower, muscular, and I personally haven't seen any. Annette has, and her description. You know, and it's easy to see your size, and it's easy to see the power, but what a lot of people don't see and what a lot of people don't know is that as massive as you are as a, in the natural, the Lord is taking you that place in the spirit. And he's going to set you at a solid, I just see you sit solidly as a pillar, but more than that, as an impenetrable force set in the front to protect as individually in your marriage, in your family, in this body, and in your ministry, that you're set up front to take a lot of the hits that will not come into the camp because you're stood there on your post. And there's many that stand up high in the watchtower looking and seeing what's coming. You are on the front line standing as a warrior, not allowing the enemy to penetrate to the weaker ones. You are standing as you would, someone would stand beside behind you in the natural, weak and unable to fight. You would protect spiritually. You're being prepared for that. And the Lord says you must grab hold of and see yourself that way. And then what came naturally for you to be this size will not come naturally to be that size in the spirit. And the Lord says, I'm putting it before you today, and it's your choice. And the Lord says, I've called you forth. And the Lord says, let it be done in Jesus' name.
I feel, and this goes along with it, but I feel the Lord said that your stature in the spirit is far greater than your stature in the natural. And that I feel like it's the stature of love that he's bringing to. There's a love of a father that he is releasing over you. And that this guard that you have over the body of Christ is because the love of Jesus is going to be so profound inside of you that the shield of, you actually be, I just see like you, almost like you becoming a shield of faith because of the great love that you have. And the Father says that the love of the Father is what's going to be the thing that's going to turn into change even your mindsets about things, that you already have a great love, and that the enemy tried to come in and to try to rob that from you, the security of knowing who you are and the love that he has for you. But the Lord says that he is releasing that, and that your stature is so great in his love that even as Jesus may have seemed frail in his person, but he was massive in love. And the Lord says that is the shield that I just see you protecting the body of Christ by a great love. And many will speak about the love that you had, that when you looked menacing to those who could not be trusted, you looked like love to those who were seeking the Father. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And if anybody doubted the authority that Gracie has, we just watched it. She told her daddy. She's letting him know this is what Jesus wants us to do. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
You preach?
You sure? You made his butt pucker, honey.
Stir things up. He's going to say things that later on the Lord's going to confirm. He's going to say, wait a minute, God showed me that before he even saw it in the word. So it's like it's being stirred up already.
The Lord is shifting the way church is done. And when we say pastor and we say preacher, we automatically look up at that. And I'm not saying that you won't be up there, but you're going to preach the gospel, and it's going to be to multitudes. But in that, you're going to be, it could be on the front lines, it could be in the work. I don't know where it's at, but you're a preacher, and the Lord says, I'm going to drop words in you, and you're going to declare things. You're going to preach the gospel, the good news to people, and people are going to be set free. All right?
Amen. Amen.
Praise you. We give you all honor and all glory. We thank you what you are setting in place, Father God. We thank you what you're establishing. We thank you, Father God, that he has a hunger and a thirst for your righteousness. He has a hunger for your word, Father God, a thirst for the Holy Spirit, and a desire, an unquenchable desire for the presence of the Most High God. And in those times of being called away, those times of the secret place, those times of the garden, Father God, you're going to impart into him, cause him to know you, cause him to see you face to face, mouth to mouth. You're going to breathe life into him, and that it's going to fill his lungs up to overflowing. And Father God, he's going to come back from the upon high. He's going to come back to the valley. He's going to come back to the situation, and he's going to declare the gospel over that situation, Father God, and people are going to be set free. His lungs are going to be filled with the righteousness, the truth, and the breath of God, and it's going to be breathed into situations and into lives, and things are going to be literally reversed and changed in Jesus' name. Yes. We thank you for
yes,
it.
Yes, Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father.
The enemy has declared loser and reject and discarded. And today the Lord professes over you that you are a treasure, that you are the apple of his eye. And he says your latter years will be 100-fold return over your former years. In other words, what was stolen, what was taken by the enemy and used for his good, the Lord is turning around and 100-fold over return for his good. And the Lord says, I'm placing with you, do not look to the left nor to the right. Continue forward. Do not look back. Do not look back. Do not go back. Today, when you come up out of the water, you're washing away. The enemy has no control, no power over you any longer. The only power that he has is what you give him. It is in your power to give to him. Other than that, he has no power. The Lord says, raise up a standard. Stir up the gift within you. Seek my face and come along. Because the Lord says that you are a treasure and that you do have a gift within you to share within the body and share with outside. And the Lord says, all that the enemy did to you and did against you, I will use to bless my people and cause my people to know me if you will allow me to come fully into your life.
And even like when Peter, they marveled at the words that came out of the disciples' mouths. They could not believe that these were the same men that were professing the gospel of Jesus in the book of Acts. And the Lord says, that's the same kind of anointing he will give to you, that people will marvel that you won't even look the same. What he wants to do with you, people won't even recognize you at first, and you'll say, no, that it's me. And then you'll tell them the story, and they'll marvel, and they'll wonder, and they'll see the reality of Jesus because of what he's done inside of your heart. Hallelujah. Yes. Devil's a liar. you, Xander. You know, when he was a lot younger, we used to put flyers on the cars and stuff at the ball game. And Xander would go out and put these flyers on all the cars. And then the next morning we'd meet on Saturday mornings for prayer. And people would take the flyers off their windshields and throw them on the ground. And Xander would go out and pick them all up. And he would come to prayer. He'd pray over every flyer, over every person who just threw that to the side. Because that's the kind of heart that he has. He's a worshiper, and he's a lover, and he's a warrior.
The Father says that you are my David of this generation. I have set you apart. I have called you. You've been back in the field, and you've been ignored. You've been set aside, and people think you're just a little kid. And the enemy has come and tried to steal everything from you. He's taken away affirmation. He's taken away certain things, and the Lord's come today to declare over you that you are my warrior. That you have a place within you, and do not let the enemy tell you any different. Don't let him tell you that to be ashamed of loving. Don't let him tell you to be ashamed of caring. Don't let him tell you to be ashamed of who you are. The Lord says that I have declared you a mighty warrior, that you move mightily, that you will yield the sword, and you will declare my word, and you will bring down strongholds, and you will fight the enemy. I will send you, and you have many victories. And what Saul had thousands, you'll have 10,000s. And there's been many Sauls in your life, and the Lord says that you are sitting waiting to be put into place, and that you shall be set in place as king. And the Lord is putting you in that place, and it's going to be a mighty place. And people are going to say, there's no way that Xander can be that way. Xander doesn't have the ability or the gifts. And many will come out of the woodworks to declare crap over you. And I say no in Jesus' name. The Lord has declared who you are today. And the Lord says, I am your father, and I am declaring over you, you are my son, you are my child, you are my warrior, your king, and I have declared in you, I'm putting the sword in your hand and the power of the Spirit in your mouth. And the Lord says that I am making you and anointing you, and I will place within you what you need to declare. The Lord says, come, draw nigh to me. There's some many things that the enemy is trying to pull you away and say into your life and pull you aside. The Lord says, put a deaf ear to it. I'm stopping up your ears. You will not hear in Jesus' name. The Lord says there's many things that were stopped in your family that you're going to pick up now. There's blessings. There is favor. There is anointings, and there is giftings that you're going to redeem in your family. You're going to take back territory. You're going to bring forth blessing, and you're going to pass it down to generation, to generation, to generation. You're going to be a mighty, mighty man for God. Father, we love you and we praise you. We thank you for this precious life. I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son.
precious. Purity and virtue and innocence. Yeah. Father, you are. I see the Father picking you up and dancing with you and speaking to you and declaring over you. The word tells us that he sings over us. There's a love song that he's singing over you and declaring over you. Father, we speak over this innocence and this purity and this virtue, Father God, that it will be passed down from generation to generation, Father God. And we thank you, Father, that she is set aside for you and your work. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
I baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Tried to take things from you, and he's done everything he could to destroy your reputation, to destroy your giftings, to destroy what your abilities and what you're called to, and he's done everything he could to distract you and take you in a different direction. And the enemy does not come after where there is no spoils, and there is great spoils within you because the Lord has placed a great treasure within you. And in that, you need to recognize that. But I think you know that, and I think you have fought for it. But the Lord says, as he puts you back into place and puts you where he's called you to be, there's going to be another wave and another attack. And the Lord says, the reason is because of what I've placed on your lips and what I've placed in your heart to declare over people. And the Lord says, the enemy will not give up, but the Lord says, you will overcome. Fear not, because I have overcome the enemy, and because I've overcome, you shall overcome. The Lord has declared over you that he has placed within you a word to speak, and in your heart, a word to declare over people.
I heard the Lord said that you're going to go through the wilderness test again, but this time you're going to have a word in your mouth, and it's a word in due season, and you're going to proclaim it with faith and power. Like, you may have proclaimed it in the past before, but you didn't see the fruit of it, and you began even to question the Lord. The enemy just like started questioning, making you question, does it work? Is it work? Is it work? And the Lord says, this time when you go through this, you're going to speak the word in due season. It's going to have power upon it, and you're going to see the fruitfulness of it, and it's going to change you on the inside. There's something inside of you that's going to adjust. The Lord says that I am building your house. You are not the maker and builder of all things, but he's the maker and builder of all things, and that there's some shifting coming on in your life and the things that you tried to build in yourself, but you built them out of hurt and out of defense, and the Lord says those things are coming down, but there's going to be such a beauty that comes out of you that's his making. He's got jasper, he's got pearl, he's got carnelian, he's got all of these beautiful jewels that he's putting in your walls, and that you will stand out and you will shine bright with a light and a color that nobody else has seen before. But if he doesn't put it in there, it'll be perverted. But the Lord says, this word right now in this season will be one that will bring forth that making that he is causing you to be. You know, you're going to prove those who came against you in error, not by the word that you speak, but by the beauty of Jesus that comes out of your life. So don't ever, you don't have to defend yourself, is all I keep hearing the Lord say. You don't have to defend yourself.
The Lord said, you went through the last wilderness in dread. This time you'll go in his power. Last time you did it in yourself. This time you'll do it in him.
That's powerful. Gina, this is your granddaughter or your great-granddaughter? Granddaughter.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for heritage and legacy. I thank you, Father God, what's passed down on the bad side, Father God, is uprooted and tore down by men and women of God that have placed themselves and gone face to face with you. But then, Father God, as that those are uprooted, Father God, then has established your word and your fruitfulness and your tree of life, Father God. And that will be passed down from generation to generation. And from this time forward, Father God, blessing shall come forth. What the enemy has meant for harm, the Lord has turned to good. Thank you, Jesus. You will have the heart of your grandmother. You will not be able to not speak the truth and declare the goodness of the Lord all the days of your life. Yes. The gospel will always be on your lips. You will worship her just like your grandmama. You will worship the King in all that you do and all that you are. Thank you, Jesus. Are you ready, baby?
Amen. Yes. Do. Well, it's Happy Valentine's Day, Jeannie.
I just hear get ready. Is this the first time you've been baptized? When did you give your heart to the Lord? Few years ago. Okay. All right. I just keep, as you're walking up, I keep hearing, get ready, get ready, get ready. Outpouring, exponential. You're going to begin to see God and understand God like you've never done before. He's calling you aside because he's going to call you into his garden. And in that garden, you're going to understand worship and understand getting to know him and being intimate, being a lover of God. And in that time, you're going to understand and know God. You're going to get to know him. And then after you come out of that time, after that outpouring, you're going to come out and you're going to be able to understand issues and problems and things. You're going to know the answers to. God's going to give you wisdom. You're going to know what to say. You're going to know what to speak. Sometimes it's going to be love. Sometimes it's going to be correction. But there's going to be an outpouring of all of that. It's not you. It's what God does in you. And the only time that you get filled up with that is when you go into that secret place. And the Lord says, I'm going to keep calling you. It's not a one-time thing. It's going to come in and go out. Come in and go out. He's going to teach you to do it every day. But there's going to be periods of time that he's going to call you alone. And you're going to have to be weeks upon time. As you grow older and as you get more into this, it'll be weeks at a time where you're set aside alone with the God. So he can pour into you so that you can pour out. Okay?
Do you like school? Do you like academics? Do you like to study? You do? Because I just keep seeing you studying. And even like some of the principles that you've learned in school, you're going to use them in your study time with the Lord. And you're smart. You're a smart girl. God's gonna use your natural ability, but he's gonna put wisdom along with it. Because when he said it, I kept seeing the books. But I just see you sitting at a table with your Bible and a pen and a notebook and just writing the things that you hear and seeing things linked together, scriptures linking together, and just revelation coming. And it's because there's people that need to hear what you have to say. You'll probably write too. I don't know if I don't know if you like to write, but writing is in your future. Thank you, Jesus. Other people sing, you'll write. Thank you, Jesus. Mm. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. You ready?
It's a new season.
For those of you that think that gospel music has gone too far, you think